So welcome to today's lecture. So because of the time constraint, we could not complete this voltage regulator in the last class. And today's discussion is all about this voltage regulator. And eventually, today is the last lecture for Unit 1. And so let me summarize what we have already discussed in Unit 1. In the very first day, we have discussed about the different types of diode models, starting with the ideal diode model. Then we have discussed about the constant voltage model of a diode, and then obviously the practical diode model. In the next two classes, we have discussed about the rectifier circuit and the filter circuits, different types of rectifiers involving full wave rectifier, half wave rectifier, bridge rectifier, and filter circuits as well. And in the last class, we have discussed about the different types of wave shaping circuits, more specifically the different types of clippers and clampers, the positive one, negative one, and the biased one, unbiased one, and the different combination. And today, the topic is all about the voltage regulator. Now, whenever we see this particular word regulator, it deals with the term regulation. So there are different types of regulation, regulatory board available. Now, what is the purpose of this type of regulators? So if I just use the word only regulator, it tries to follow certain rules or set of prescribed laws to achieve something. Now, in connection to electronic circuits, whenever we say the term like voltage regulator, that means it's a kind of circuit which will follow a certain voltage specification. Or in other words, if I just go to this block diagram, then you can see that I can always visualize this voltage regulator as a black box for which the input is a source, might be variable one or maybe a constant voltage source, and it is supplying the signal to a load. So this voltage regulator I can consider as a box, as a connecting device between the source and the load. Now eventually you will find this voltage regulator at the last block of any power supply unit. So in the power supply unit, there are different circuit modules available. First one is the rectifier circuit, the full wave rectifier. Then we have the filter circuit. And apart from that, this voltage regulator is an important component of this power supply unit. Now, the purpose of this voltage regulator is to supply a constant voltage to a load. So you have the source side here, which is connected to the load side by means of this voltage regulator. So voltage regulator basically performs this operation. That means the constant voltage to the load. Now, whenever we say constant voltage, the voltage may not vary over a wide range. Whenever we say it's a constant voltage, it's not essentially true that the voltage is always constant. That means V load, this plus to minus, this load voltage is always constant. But the fluctuations or the variations are allowed, but to a certain limit. And that is basically prescribed by the voltage regulator. So there could have been two different types, or there could have been two different reasons for which this variation in the load voltage may happen. One is that the input signal, this VSS, the source might be variable. Now, if the source is variable, you can expect that the load might be variable. I mean, the V load might be variable if the proper action is not taken. Or in other words, in the load side, you have, let us assume that you have a load resistance over here. Now, even if the source is constant, is a constant voltage source, but still if the load is a variable one, this RL, the load resistance, if it is variable, then also you can see that the load voltage is not constant until and unless we use a voltage regulator in between. So voltage regulator basically performs two different operations with the same goal. The first one is that even the input signal is a variable one, I mean the DC signal, the input DC signal, even if it's a variable one, but it will try to develop or provide a constant voltage to the load. And secondly, even if the input voltage is constant and your load resistance is a variable one, then also it tries to provide a constant voltage to the load. So these are the two different operations being done by any voltage regulator. So accordingly, there are two terms associated with this voltage regulation. One is known as the line regulation, and second one is known as the load regulation. Now, before going to this line regulation and load regulation, let us see which particular device we can use for the purpose of this regulation. Now, for the development of a new voltage regulator circuit, we will be employing a Zener diode. Perhaps you have studied in your basic electronics course that Zener diode is a particular type of diode which is intended to operate in reverse bias region at the breakdown region. Now, let us consider these IV characteristics of any Zener diode. So in the forward bias, you know that the IV characteristics will be same just like any standard diode. That means it will follow this exponential e to the power VT by eta VT minus 1 multiplied with IS. So IF, this forward current, is nothing but exponential e to the power VT by eta VT minus 1 multiplied with IS. So this will be the exponential graph. So here they have considered the constant voltage model. So that's why this voltage, they have considered this voltage, this on voltage is essentially constant. So what happens in the reverse bias? In reverse bias, there are two different regions of operation. One is the reverse voltage when this is less than this VZ. VZ is known to be the breakdown region or breakdown voltage of this particular Zener diode. Now, between zero to this, Zener diode will be off because the current that is flowing through the diode is essentially small, insignificantly small. So we can just neglect this one. And at VZ, what happens is at VZ, enormous amount of current will flow through the diode with a slight change or almost no change in the voltage. If you just follow this particular diagram from this point to that point, you will see that there is a significant variation of current. One current has been shown over here, which is IZT, that is the Zener test current. This is the maximum current IZM allowed for any Zener diode. And the region from which this particular operation starts, this is known as the IZK or Zener knee current. So this one is the Zener knee current. This current is the Zener knee current. Whenever this particular variation in the IV characteristics takes place. So you see that from this point to that point, there is a large variation of current from IZK to IZM. IZT is the Zener test current, any Zener current within this particular range. And IZK is the minimum current within the Zener region or breakdown region. And IZM is the maximum allowable current. So in the first class, I have already told you that for any diode, you cannot allow enormous amount of current to flow through the diode. In this case, you can expect that the diode might get damaged. So obviously, there is a maximum limit of current which can be flown through the diode. And that can be obtained from the power dissipation data as provided by the manufacturer. So let us consider that IZM is the maximum Zener current that can be tolerated by this particular Zener diode. And IZT is the test current, Zener test current. And IZK, the knee current. The knee current. That means your current through the Zener diode must be greater than IZK so that the Zener diode enters into the breakdown region. So in order to ensure that the Zener diode is entering into the breakdown region, you have to ensure that the current through the diode, the reverse current through the diode, must be greater than or equal to IZK, which is known to be the knee current of Zener. So let us start from this point. So the forward bias starts from this point onwards in the right hand direction. Whenever the applied voltage VF is greater than or equal to zero, we can consider that the Zener diode is operating in the forward bias direction. Now, whenever the input voltage or anode to cathode voltage is less than zero, then the Zener diode enters into the reverse bias region. So within this range, from zero to this minus VZ, up to this point, the Zener diode will act as an open switch because there is no current that is flowing through the diode, or even if the current is flowing through the diode, the amount is very small. Now, whenever the reverse bias voltage is equal to VZ, or it is shown like minus VZ, so anode to cathode voltage is minus VZ, or we can say that cathode to anode voltage is plus VZ. So whenever this voltage becomes minus VZ, or the reverse bias voltage equal to plus VZ, then the Zener diode enters into the breakdown region. Then also we can say that in the reverse bias region, the inner diode will act as a closed switch, unlike your forward bias region. So far we know that the diode will be acting as a forward bias. I mean, diode will be acting as a closed switch in the forward bias region, and it will act as an open switch in the reverse bias region. But whenever we operate the diode in the general breakdown region, then also we can ensure that since the current that is flowing through the diode is significantly high, so we can ensure that diode is on. That means the switch is closed. But remember that during this region also, the maximum general current or the current that is flowing through the general diode cannot exceed this IZM value. So there are two different threshold for the general diode to operate in the general breakdown region. One is IZK, which is nothing but the general knee current, and the current through the general diode must be greater than IZK, greater than or equal to IZK, to allow the diode, to allow the general diode to enter into the breakdown region. And IZM is the maximum current which you can allow to be flown through the diode in order to protect the diode against any thermal breakdown. So let us just observe this symbol of a zener diode. Just like an ideal diode, I mean normal diode, anode side, cathode side is there. Now in the cathode side, you'll see that there's a Z sign, looks something like that. It's not a straight line, rather you have a Z sign shown. So it indicates it's a zener diode. Now here in this diagram, you see that this is the cathode terminal, this one is the cathode terminal, and this one is the anode terminal. Now here the cathode to anode voltage is positive because anode is more negative with respect to cathode. So cathode to anode voltage is positive means what? The zener diode will be operated in the reverse bias region. So there is no doubt about that. Whenever the anode to cathode voltage is positive or VAK is greater than zero, we can say that the diode is under forward bias. And whenever the anode to cathode voltage is negative, we can say that the diode is in the reverse bias region. Now, whenever the value of this reverse bias voltage, this V, reverse bias voltage plus to minus, you see that anode voltage is negative with respect to cathode. So this V is basically a negative quantity over here. Now, whenever the value of V is within this particular range, that means 0 to VZ. For example, let us assume that VZ is equal to 12 volt. Now, whenever your input voltage is less than 0, but at the same time, it is greater than minus 12 volt, just like say minus 5 volt. So in that case, the diode will be reverse biased, but it has not entered into the general breakdown region. So initially you start with 0 volt, then minus 1, minus 2, minus 3, minus 4, minus 5, minus 6, so on. Until and unless this reverse bias voltage becomes minus 12, then the zener diode cannot enter into the breakdown region. So as long as this condition is holding good, that means VZ is greater than V is greater than 0 volt. VZ is obviously, we are considering here with respect to the anode to cathode voltage. So that's why, so cathode to anode voltage here. So that's why it should be positive one, VZ. So as long as this condition holds good, we say that this zener diode will be acting as an open switch. So these two connections, I mean, these two terminals are not connected together. This cathode and anode, they are not connected together. Now, whenever this reverse voltage that we are applying across this cathode to anode, whenever this reverse voltage is equal to VZ, then you see that because of this general breakdown operation, the current will be flowing through the general diode in the reverse direction, obviously. And we can say that the connection is established. That means the general diode will be on. Now you can ask that what is the difference between the general diode operating in the general region and any normal diode operating in the forward bias region. Now, whenever any normal diode operates in the forward bias region, you know that the current voltage relationship looks like an exponential one. So whenever the current through the diode increases, the voltage across the diode is also changing. Although for constant voltage model, we are assuming that it's a constant one, like 0.7 volt for silicon diode and 0.3 volt for germanium diode. But practically speaking, whenever the current through any diode is increasing, so the voltage drop across this anode to cathode terminal is no longer constant, which we have explained also in the last class while discussing about the limiter circuit or the clipper circuit, that there was a straight line variation up to certain range, and beyond that range we can't expect that this output voltage will be clipped up at a constant level. Rather, there will be some change in the output voltage, some increase in the output voltage, because of the fact that the current, whenever the current is increasing through the diode, the voltage drop across the two terminals, this is not constant. Now, however, unlike this case, unlike this forward bias case, whenever the generator is operated at the breakdown region, then you see that even if the current changes over a wide range from IZA to IZM, so you must appreciate that there is a large variation of current from this point to that point. IZK is like, say, some milliampere, say 1 milliampere, 0.5 milliampere, and IZM could be as high as 100 milliampere or 150 milliampere. Now, over this large range from 1 milliampere to 150 milliampere, the generator remains, I mean, the general voltage or the voltage drop across the diode remains almost constant. Obviously, there will be some fluctuation, some variation is there, but this is insignificantly small. Ideally, we can say that, okay, it is almost constant, but practically some variation is there. But and this particular property is exploited to operate this Zener diode as an important block of any voltage regulator circuit. Now, this slide shows the Zener diode as a regulator. So we have connected one battery over here, VI. So this terminal is positive, this terminal is negative. It is connected to Zener diode in such a way that the diode, that means this particular supply voltage, this VI, will make the diode reverse bias. We have connected this resistance in series and this RL in shunt with the Zener diode. Now, what happens when during the positive half cycle? So here we have considered, okay, VI is positive with this, I mean, this potential is positive. So that's why so this particular diode will always be acting in the reverse bias mode. But even if in the reverse bias mode, you know that even if I change this value of VI, then also initially this Zener diode will be acting in the reverse bias region. That means between 0 to minus VZ within that particular range. Now, suppose I am changing the value of VI. Initially 0, and then I am increasing the value of VI. Now, initially, when the value of VI is less than VZ, suppose VZ is equal to 12 volt here, we know that the general voltage is equal to 12 volt. Whenever the cathode anode voltage is equal to 12 volt, then only the Zener diode enters into the breakdown region. That means what? At this particular point. At this particular point. Whenever the cathode to anode voltage is equal to 12 volt, or in other words, I can say that anode to cathode voltage is equal to minus 12 volt, then only the diode enters into the breakdown region. And initially, let us start VI with, say, 1 volt. Now, as VI is equal to 1 volt, and here we find that this cathode to anode voltage equal to, like, plus 1, or anode to cathode voltage equal to minus 1. So we can say that this Zener diode has not entered into the breakdown region. It is under reverse bias condition, but it has not entered into the breakdown region. The current that is flowing through the diode is very small, and that these two terminals, cathode and anode, they are not connected together. So it's an open circuit, so no current will flow through the diode, and you can expect that the current will flow through this R-RL combination just like this. Now, as you increase the value from 1 volt to 2 volt, 2 volt to 3 volt, 3 volt to 4 volt, you are increasing the value of VI. A point will come when VI matches with VZ. Now, when VI is equal to VZ or greater than VZ, then you find that the Zener diode will be on because it has entered into the breakdown region. Zener diode will be on, and as long as it is on, the voltage across the Zener diode will be remaining constant at VZ. So even if you increase the value of VI from say 12 volt to say 18 volt, 18 volt to say 20 volt, as long as it is under the control of this VZ or of this particular Zener diode to regulate the voltage, you will find that the voltage across these two terminals will be remaining constant. Now the fact is that whenever the Zener diode is on at general breakdown region, then you'll see that, once again, if I go back to this particular slide, when the IV characteristics of Zener diode is shown, you'll see that the current variation is significantly high, whereas the voltage variation is very small. ideally zero, but practically very small voltage variation. So if I want to compute the general resistance within that particular range from this point to that point, the general resistance is very small, in the order of few ohms only. In the reverse bias region, as long as input voltage is less than the general breakdown, then the general diode was off. And here you see that the voltage variation is there, but there is no current variation. When the horizontal line is there, line is present, this blue line. So voltage variation is there, but there is no current variation. So if you compute the resistance value, delta V by delta I, you will see that delta I will be zero. So the resistance is equal to infinite, as you know. Now, if I consider this particular range where the voltage variation is insignificantly small, but there is a significant current variation from IZK to IZM, then you see that the if you compute the value of this general resistance within that particular region, breakdown region, this value will be very small because delta VZ is very small with respect to the variation of delta IZ. So general resistance, I can consider a few ohms or tens of ohms, like 10 ohms, 5 ohms, very small. Now let us once again come back to this circuit. Now when the general diode is on, you expect that this general diode can be replaced by one battery VZ with this terminal positive and this terminal negative, battery VZ just like this. And if I consider a practical general diode, then obviously there will be some resistance, general resistance in series with this battery. So this is nothing but ZZ. So VZ, ZZ combination over here. Now the value of this ZZ is very small with respect to the value of RL, that is the load resistance. As a matter of fact, whenever the total current is entering at that particular node, so it will be divided. Total current, suppose the total current is IT, that is flowing through this resistance R, and whenever it reaches at this particular point, then it will be divided into two different branches. One is through the general diode, through this path, and the other one is through the load resistance, through this path. Now you know that if the voltage difference being the same between these two points, now if this resistance is small, general resistance is small with respect to the load resistance, then obviously the major portion of the current, majority of the current will flow through this general diode, and a significantly small amount will flow through this load resistance. Now, this can be allowed as long as this current that is flowing through the general diode is within the limit. So what is the limit? The limit is IZM, that is the maximum general current which can be tolerated by the general diode at breakdown region. So as long as this value is equal to, I mean, the current that is flowing through this general diode is IZM maximum. So up to this point, I can regulate, or the circuit can regulate the input voltage. But beyond this point, if you increase VI further beyond this particular value, then what happens? Suppose you are increasing VI, so the current that is flowing through the circuit is constant. So VI minus VZ by R. So if you increase VI, this current will also increase. Current that is flowing, because this point is having a potential of VZ, this point is having a potential of VI. So VI minus VZ divided by R, this is the current that is flowing through R. Now if VI is constant, this current will be constant. But if you increase VI, this current will also increase. Now there are two different paths for the current. One is through the general diode, second one is through the load resistance. Most of the current will flow through this general diode because it offers least resistance with respect to RL. Now hence, if the amount of current is so high that the current flowing through the general diode exceeds IZM, in that case, what happens? The enormous current will flow through this diode and eventually the diode get damaged. So we cannot regulate the input voltage because the circuit will be disturbed. So there must be some maximum limit for the input signal, which we can use in this particular case. Now, obviously, apart from the value of RL, so we have to consider the value of R as well. Because if R, this series resistance, is too large, then what happens? We already know that this VI minus VZ divided by R is the current that is flowing through the through this circuit, through this resistance R. And this current is divided into two different segments. One is through this general diode and second one is through this load resistance. Now, if the resistance R is too large, then the total current that is flowing through this loop, total current that is flowing through this resistance R will be very small. Now, not only the general current is less than IZM, but also you have to ensure that the general current must be greater than IZK. So So there are two limits. One is IZK and second one is IZM. One is the knee current and second one is the maximum current. So the Zener current or current through the Zener diode, that is IZ, must be greater than IZK, and at the same time it should be less than IZM. Now if the value of R is very high, so in that case you find that the current, total current IT that is flowing through the circuit is very small, and one part is flowing through RL, the rest part will flow through IZ, this VZ or this through Zener diode. Now if the value of IT itself is very small, then there is a possibility that this IZ that is flowing through the Zener diode is less than IZK. So in that case the regulation will be lost. So you have to maintain the minimum current rating, that is IZK, through the Zener diode. And similarly, if R is too small, then also you'll find that, so VI minus VZ is the difference of voltage between these two points. So this divided by R will give you the current that is flowing. So if R is too small, then you find that the current that is flowing through this circuit is very large. So IT is very large. The current that is flowing through this resistance is very large. Now one part is supported by IZ and the other part is supported by this IL. Now if IT is large enough, then obviously, and since this particular Zener diode is having a smaller resistance with respect to RL, so you can expect that the majority of the current will flow through this Zener diode. And if IT value itself is very large because of the low value of this resistance R, then you find that this current that is flowing through the Zener diode could be higher than IZM, which is not at all prescribed. So you have to maintain these two conditions so that the Zener diode can be used as a regulator. So already I have told you that there are two types of regulation. There are two types of fluctuation for which the regulation is needed. One is the line regulation. That means the input voltage changes. If input voltage changes, VI, as I've already mentioned in the last slide, that if input voltage is very large, if all the parameters are constant, that means same series resistance R, same load resistance RL, and same Zener diode with a fixed Zener breakdown. But if the input voltage increases, obviously you must appreciate that the total current that is flowing through the series resistance R will increase. And as a matter of fact, the current that is flowing through the Zener diode might be increased, and hence it can exceed the maximum limit and the regulation will be lost. So that is not at all advisable. So there must be some specific variation of the input voltage with respect to specific variation of the output voltage. So this line regulation is a particular term which is defined as a change in the output voltage or a given change in the input voltage. So we expect that this line regulation should be as small as possible. That means suppose Vin changes by say 10 volt and Vout changes by say only 1 volt. Vin changes by 10 volt, suppose Vin is from 1 to 11, but Vout changes from say 12 to 13 only, just like this. So in that case, I can say that the line regulation is only 10%. So delta Vin is 10 and delta Vout is 1. That is always advisable that this ratio should be as small as possible, this line regulation. And second one is the load regulation. In case of load regulation, the input voltage, that means the signal, that is VI is constant, but the load resistance is varying. RL is varying. So now you know that general resistance is fixed and very small. Say a few ohms, few tens of ohms, like 5 ohms or 7 ohms is pretty small. The load resistance is not constant. RL is not constant. RL is varying. Now, if RL is very small, you understand that if RL is very small, so we can always make RL like say 1 ohm or 2 ohm. We can make it, if RL is very small or essentially short circuit. So in that case, most of the current will flow through RL and very small amount of current will flow through Zener current. And if that current is less than IZK, regulation is lost. Secondly, if RL is very high, ideally infinite, if RL is very high, ideally open circuit, infinite, then the total current is contributed by only Zener current, that is IZ. So now if this value is higher than IZM, then also regulation is lost. So accordingly, another term is specified, which is known as the load regulation, which is given by the ratio of two terms. One is known as this VNL minus VFL divided by VFL. What is VNL? VNL is the no load output voltage and VFL is the full load output voltage. Now for the load resistance, if I consider two extreme conditions are present. One is the no load condition, and second one is the full load condition. Now, make no mistake that whenever we say no load, it doesn't mean that the load resistance is absent. Most of the time, students make this mistake, most often, that if I say that VNL, that means no load output voltage, that means that no load means there is no load present. It's not like that. Whenever we say no load voltage, that means there is no load current present. There is no load current. That means the load resistance is maximum. Load resistance is maximum so that there is no load current. And whenever we say full load output voltage, full load means what? So always try to remember that whenever we say full load, so full load current. Full load output voltage means the output voltage when the full load current is flowing through the circuit. So when can you expect that full load current will flow through the circuit? Whenever these two terminals, these output terminals, these two terminals are short circuited. I mean, RL is not their simple short circuit condition. So there are two conditions. One is the no load condition. Second one is the full load condition. So if I make these two terminals open, if I make RL out of this circuit, that means if these two terminals are not connected, so it will be an open circuit condition for RL, open circuit. That means what is the load current? No load current. There will be no load current because the load is absent, so no load current. RL equal to infinite. We have just kept these two terminals open. So RL infinite, so no load current. So the corresponding voltage that we'll be getting over here is the VNL, that is no load voltage. And now if I connect these two terminals by means of this a simple wire, a short circuit kind of thing, then what happens is almost the total current will flow through this. Then what happens? The voltage that would get across these two terminals, this is known as the full load voltage because the full load current is flowing through this. So accordingly, we have defined this load regulation, this VNL minus VFL over divided by VFL. So obviously we expect that this load regulation should be as small as possible. Now let us try to understand this notion of voltage regulation by means of two problems. One deals with this line regulation and second one deals with the load regulation. So simple circuit we have considered here. The question is the determine the minimum and maximum input voltages that can be regulated by the generator. So perhaps you understand by now that what is the meaning of regulation. So the meaning of regulation is that even if the input voltage changes by a large amount, but the output voltage remains essentially constant, the variation will be very small, and accordingly we can calculate the line regulation. Now this question suggests that you have to find out the minimum and the maximum input voltage that can be regulated by the generator. Okay, now there are certain given data. It says that VZ is equal to 5.1 volt and IZ equal to 49 milliampere. So the test current is 49. If the test current is 49, then VZ will be 5.1 volt. Knee current IZK, at which the general operation starts, the general breakdown operation starts, so this is at 1 milliampere. So obviously the test current should be higher than that. So test current is 49, it is 1 milliampere. ZZ, that is the general resistance, we have considered that general resistance is small enough, but not zero. This is 7 ohms only. And this PD max is also given, the maximum power dissipation, that is 1 watt. So these are the given data. Now based on this given data, we have to find out the minimum and the maximum input voltage that can be regulated by the generator. And this resistance is 100 ohms. The series resistance is 100 ohms over here. Now, we know that this Zener diode, this IN4733A, this can be modeled by means of one voltage source in series with a resistance. I can always represent this Zener diode by means of a voltage source with this side positive and this side negative because it is operated under reverse bias condition and Zener breakdown region. So this side positive, so cathode terminal is more positive with respect to the anode terminal. So this side positive, this side negative, and we have one load resistance, I mean general resistance in series with this VZ. So we can always find out the output. So what is the output voltage? The output voltage is nothing but this general voltage VZ plus the general current IZ multiplied with ZZ, as simple as that. Vout is nothing but this VZ. We have a resistance, we have a battery over here with this side positive and this side negative in series with, that means this type of battery is there, this type of battery, is present over here, but a constant one. It's not a variable one. It will be constant battery VZ will be there in place of this Zener diode. So we are interested in finding out the equivalent circuit for this Zener diode. You have already seen the equivalent circuit for any diode. You have this VD on and RD. That means the dynamic resistance of the diode. So any diode can be equivalently represented by means of one on voltage of the diode in series with a dynamic resistance of the diode. So similarly, for Zener diode, you can replace this Zener diode by means of a battery, but it's not a variable one. A battery is there, a VZ battery with this terminal positive, and this terminal negative, just like this one, just like this VIN, but not variable one. And in series, you have a Zener resistance, that is ZZ. Okay. So how to find out this V out, potential difference between these two points, the output voltage? This is nothing but VZ plus the current that is flowing IZ multiplied with ZZ. Now you have to find out the minimum value of this V out under the voltage regulation condition. Now, since basically it is so this V out can be so you can have two different equation. One is like you find out V out whenever the current is equal to your 49 milliampere, as specified over here. When IZ equal to 49 milliampere, you know the value of VZ equal to 5.1 volt here. That is fine. And whenever the value of IZ is equal to 1 milliampere, then you have to find out the value of this V out. So how to find it out? So this value is constant. This 5.1 volt is constant. There is a VZ, that VZ is equal to 5.1, and for which your current is equal to 49 milliampere. The current equal to 49 milliampere. But you never know what is this VZ value. You never know what is the VZ value. VZ can be obtained by two parameters. One is 5.1 volt at 49 milliampere, and you have to find out this V out at 1 milliampere. So this V out is equal to 5.1 volt minus whenever the current changes from IZ to IZK, what is the difference in the output voltage? The difference in the output voltage can be represented by IZ minus IZK into ZZ, and that comes out to be 4.76 volt. So this is V out. V out is equal to 4.76 volt because the V out changes because of the change in the value of the current that is flowing through the diode. Because you have a VZ constant over here. Constant VZ is there, and in series with the constant VZ, you have one ZZ. So if the current flowing through the diode is small, then the output voltage will be small. And if the current flowing through the diode is more, then the output voltage will be more. Now it has been specified that when the IZ is equal to 49 milliampere, then this value is equal to 5.1 volt. And when IZ is equal to 1 milliampere, that means when IZ is equal to IZK, you have to find out what is the value of V out. So this 5.1 volt minus of this IZ minus IZK into ZZ. And if you put the value 49 and 1, so 48 milliampere multiplied with 7 ohms, so ultimately it will give you 4.76 volt. So V out will be 4.76 volt. So this is the minimum regulated voltage that can be obtained from the circuit. So minimum regulated voltage, that is 4.76 volt. Now under this condition, what is the minimum input voltage? So minimum input voltage V in minimum is equal to IZK into R, because under this condition, whenever the current through the diode is equal to IZK, that means the Zener knee current, then only you can expect that it has started or it has entered into the region of regulation. So the current will be equal to simple IZK, because there is no other load resistance present. So the total current that is flowing through this resistance IT, that is equal to IZ. So whenever the current is equal to IZK through this Zener diode, so we can appreciate that this is the current flowing through the resistance R as well. So what will be V in minimum? If you apply KVL, so V in minimum will be equal to IZK into R plus V out. Now V out you have already calculated to be 4.76 volt. We put the value over here, so 4.86 volt. So this is the minimum input voltage, that is 4.86 volt, that has been regulated by by means of this Zener diode at 4.76 volt. So this is the minimum one. Now to find out the maximum one, that means the maximum regulated voltage, we have to identify maximum general current that can be allowed. So in order to find out this IZM, it has not been specified clearly, but one parameter is provided, that is the PD max, which is the maximum power dissipation. So PD max equal to 1 watt perhaps. So 1 watt, that was PD max as specified in this data sheet, that is 1 watt. And VZ is equal to 5.1. So accordingly, you can find out what is the value of this IZM, that is 196 milliampere. So 196 milliampere is the maximum possible general current that is allowed under the breakdown region. Now, you know that whenever the input voltage was like, I mean, whenever the IZ is equal to 49 milliampere, then the output was like 5.1. I mean, V out was 5.1. That was VZ only. Now, whenever your input voltage equal to, I mean, input current equal to 196 milliampere, you have to find out the value of this V out. So this time it will be plus 5.1 because more current is flowing now. When IZ was greater than when IZ, I mean, the current that is flowing through the general diode is less than 49 milliampere, then you have to put a minus sign over here because it is less than that. And this time the current is higher than IZT. This time it is 196 milliampere. So the voltage drop will be higher, obviously, with respect to 5.1. So what is the change in the voltage? So change in the voltage delta VZ. So this delta VZ is equal to delta IZ into ZZ, as simple as that. You have a constant VZ over here, and in series you have a ZZ. So total V out is the summation of these two voltage. One is the VZ voltage, VZ, and second one is delta IZ into ZZ. ZZ is constant, that is 7 ohms always. And what is delta IZ? Delta IZ here, IZM minus IZ. So IZM is 196 milliampere and IZ is 49 milliampere. So difference is, you can calculate 147 milliampere multiplied with 7 ohms. So if we add with the 5.1, you can have 6.13 volts. So that is fine, 6.13 volts. So 6.13 volt will be the regulated output voltage across these two terminals. Now, under this condition, what will be the maximum input voltage? So maximum input voltage, following the same formula, you can write, this time the current that is flowing through this resistance is IZM, the maximum general current. So IZM into R, 100 ohms, plus V out. So if you put those values, you'll find that because of this large value of IZM of 196 milliampere, this V in maximum is equal to 25.7 volt. I see the difference. If I just compare these two slides parallelly, the minimum input voltage was like 4.86 volt and the minimum output voltage was 4.76 volt. And the maximum input voltage is equal to 25.7 volt. And the maximum output voltage is 6.13 volt. So for the input voltage, the variation is from 4.86 to 25.7. So more than 5 times. 4.86 is less than 5 and 25.7 is higher than 25. So the variation is more than 5 times for the input voltage, like 5 to 25 volt. But for the output voltage, the variation is from 4.76 to 6.13. So this is the specialty of the general diode, that even if the input voltage varies over a wide range, wider range from 5 volt to 25 volt, but the output voltage remains essentially constant across 5 volt or 5 point something. 4.76 to 6.13. So the delta V out is very small. So from this particular problem, you can easily calculate what is the value of the line regulation. So here the line regulation will be applicable because there is no load resistance. So the line regulation will be applicable. And the input voltage delta V in is like 25.7 minus 4.86. And delta V out is 6.13 minus 4.76. So if you just put those values, you'll be getting something close to 10% or less than that. So this is all about the line regulation. That means the general diode is capable enough to regulate the variation in the input voltage, and it will develop a fairly constant output voltage. It's not that much. And even if I consider that ZZ equal to zero, that means the general resistance is zero. In that case, always irrespective of the current, the voltage across these two terminals will be constant. So delta V out will be zero. If ZZ equal to zero, so irrespective of the value of your current that is flowing through the generator under breakdown, the V out will be always equal to VZ. But you have to ensure that the current must be greater than IZK and should be less than IZM. Now, under this condition, it will be constant. But if I allow non-zero general resistance, like 7 ohm resistance, so in that case, you'll see that it will be like variation is like 4.76 to 6.13 volt. So you can easily calculate the amount of regulation, line regulation. So next comes the problem of load regulation. So here they have considered the same circuit, similar type of circuit, but they have connected one load resistance in shunt with the Zener diode. And it is asked to determine the minimum and the maximum load currents for which the Zener diode will maintain the regulation. So some load resistance RL is connected over here. Now you need to find out what should be the minimum value of RL and what should be the maximum value of RL so that the Zener diode maintains the regulation. Here the input voltage is constant. It's constant at 24 volt. It's constant at 24 volt. 470 ohm resistance is there, moderate one, in the series path. And the load resistance RL is there in shunt with the Zener diode. Now, obviously, you understand that if RL is very small, as I've already explained, if RL is very small, so here you find that if this VZ is given like 12 volt, so the current that is flowing through this resistance it will be constant. It's like 24 volt minus 12 volt by this 470 ohms. This will be constant current through this resistance. Now, so there will be a division of current at this particular point. One is through Zener diode and second one is through this load resistance. Now, if the value of load resistance is very small, so in that case, what happens is the most of the current will flow through this RL. Most of the current, if this resistance is very small, so most otherwise there will be a current division law, as you know, and accordingly the current will be distributed between these two paths, two branches. Otherwise, you can calculate for a rough calculation. I can say that if RL equal to is very small with respect to this resistance, then most of the current will flow through this. But the total current is constant. Total current is constant. Some IT is there. Some few milliamperes is there. Now, if most of the current is flowing through this, the rest of the current will flow through this load resistance. Through this Zener diode. Now, if this current, if the rest amount of current, if this value is less than IZK, so in that case the regulation is lost. So it cannot be operated as a regulator. In other words, if the resistance value RL is very large, ideally an open circuit kind of thing, and whatever be the current that is flowing through this resistance, the total current will flow through this Zener diode. And under this condition, if this value is less than IZM, then your circuit is safe and it can maintain the regulation. But if the current is flowing through the Zener diode is higher than IZM, in that case the regulation is lost. So accordingly, you have to find out the value of RL, the two extreme values for RL. Now, these are the given data. VZ is equal to 12 volt, IZK is equal to 1 milliampere, IZM is equal to 50 milliampere. That means the maximum Zener current is 50 milliampere only. And they have assumed that the Zener diode is ideal. That means Z is equal to 0 ohm. That means whenever the Zener diode is entering into the breakdown region, in that case, the voltage developed across this will be constant because this Z value is equal to 0. So it will be 12 volt kind of. Now let us see what is the IZ max. So as you understand that IZ max will only happen when there is no RL. Then only, because here the current is flowing through this path, and if there is no RL, that means IL minimum is equal to 0 milliampere. IL minimum equal to 0 milliampere. That means there is no RL. RL is absent. Open circuit kind of thing. So in that case, what happens, whatever be the amount of current that is flowing through this, so what is that current? You can easily find it out. Here is, we have 24 volt here, V in. What is VZ? VZ is specified like 12 volt. So 24 minus 12 divided by this 470 ohms. So 24 minus 12 is 12, 12 by 470 ohms. So this is equal to 25.5 milliampere. So this is IZ max. This is IZ max because 24 volt here and you have 12 volt here divided by this 470, because there is no other element which can carry this current. So the total current must be flowing through the Zener diode. So what is that current? That is 25.5 milliampere. Now let us check whether this value is less than the Zener maximum current or not. Now we have calculated it to be 25.5 milliampere, and we have seen that the Zener maximum current is 50 milliampere. So 25.5 is well within the limit, within 1 to 50 milliampere, within that particular range. So IZ max is equal to 25.5 milliampere is a permissible one. So Zener diode can tolerate, can bear this amount of current. So in that case, what is IL minimum? IL minimum equal to 0 milliampere. Or in other words, I can say that the RL maximum, that means the maximum load resistance, would have been infinite. That means an open circuit kind of thing. Now, let us consider the value of this IL maximum, how to find out the IL maximum. Now here the total current is constant, as you understand. Total current is constant, 25.5 milliampere. So when RL was absent, that means an open circuit kind of thing, the 25.5 milliampere is carried by this generator in the reverse breakdown region. Fine. But when RL is present, then what happens? This a portion of this 25.5 milliampere will be flowing through this RL. Now you have to ensure that the minimum current that is flowing through the generator must be at least 1 milliampere, that is IZK. It cannot be less than 1 milliampere. If it is less than 1 milliampere, then the regulation will be lost. So the total current that is entering at this particular node is 25.5, I mean entering this node is 25.5 milliampere. Now suppose there is some load resistance, but you have to provide at least 1 milliampere current through this diode. So 1 milliampere will be flowing through this path. So rest 25.5 minus 1, so 24.5 will flow through this load resistance, 24.5 milliampere, right? Then how to find out the value of this load resistance? You know that this value, I mean the voltage difference will be is constant because we have considered ZZ to be 0 ohm. So as long as it is maintaining regulation, this is not diode, so this voltage drop will be 12 volt always. So 12 volt difference here. So same is the voltage drop across the load resistance, 12 volt. What is the current that is flowing? 24.5 milliampere. So 12 ohms, 12 volt divided by 24.5 milliampere. Yeah. So this will give you 490 ohms. So 490 ohms is the minimum value of the load resistance. Minimum value of load resistance is 490 ohms. Now, if you make any attempt to reduce it further, this is for RL minimum. So 490 ohms. Now, if you reduce it further, like 450 ohms or 400 ohms. Now what happens, the total current is fixed, that is 25.5. Now if you reduce it further, then obviously the more amount of current will be drawn by this load resistance. So more than 24.5 will be drawn by the load resistance. And since the total current is constant at 25.5, so rest amount of current will flow through this generator diode. And eventually it will be less than 1 milliampere. And if it is less than 1 milliampere, it cannot sustain the regulation, voltage regulation. So this is the minimum value of the load resistance. So you cannot go beyond this point. So minimum value is equal to 490 ohms for the load resistance, and the maximum value is equal to infinite. That means an open circuit. So we have got the answer. Determine the minimum and the maximum load currents for which the generator will maintain the regulation. So the minimum load current is equal to 0 milliampere. So this is the open load, I mean no load condition. This is the voltage over here, because here you find that as long as the generator resistance is equal to zero ohms, so the no load voltage and the full load voltage, it will be the same because the generator resistance is zero here. Otherwise, you'll see that there will be some fluctuation between these two points, VNL and VFL. So when IL minimum equal to 0 milliampere, there is a no load condition, that means there is no load current, and this is the full load condition, the maximum load current is present for a particular minimum value of load resistance, the full load condition. So VNL minus VFL by VFL. So accordingly, you can find out the percentage. So here it will be 0% only because the general resistance is absent. But if I incorporate some non-zero value for the general resistance, in that case, you can have some non-zero, but a small value for this load regulation. Now with this, let us once again try to combine the concept of these general diodes with the limiter circuits that we have discussed last day, the clipper circuit or limiter circuit. Now let us consider that we have a simple limiter circuit kind of thing, but instead of having a simple simple diode, low power diode, we have connected one generator diode in this fashion. So the cathode terminal is connected to this point and the anode terminal is connected to ground, and the input voltage is like a sinusoidal signal. For example, I'm assuming that this VZ equal to 5 volt and input signal is like 10 sine of omega t. So input peak is higher than the general breakdown voltage. So general voltage breakdown is at 5 volt and the input signal goes from 10 to minus 10 kind of thing. So how does this circuit operate, or how does the output waveform look like? So first you just observe the situation under reverse bias condition or during the negative half cycle. So during the negative half cycle, you understand that this side is more positive with respect to this side. So under negative half cycle, when the input signal goes negative, so this generator diode will be on, just like any low power diode, a normal diode, it will be on. And these two terminals are connected. And if I assume a practical diode, So there will be voltage drop will take place. That voltage drop is like 0.7 volt. So from this point to that point, anode to cathode voltage will be 0.7 volt. And here it is measured with respect to cathode to anode, because this terminal is anode is connected to ground. And so anode to cathode voltage, whenever this diode is on, anode to cathode voltage will be like 0.7 volt plus 0.7 volt. So cathode to anode voltage, that means the voltage at this point with respect to the voltage at the ground potential will be minus 0.7 volt. So this is the scenario during the reverse, I mean the negative half cycle. Now what happens during the positive half cycle? Now in the positive half cycle, you don't expect that initially, in the positive half cycle, initially the input voltage starts increasing. Like general voltage is like 5 volt. So general voltage is like 5 volt and the input voltage is like initially 1 volt, 2 volt, just like this. So initially during the positive half cycle, this generator diode is off. So the current that is flowing through the diode is very small, insignificantly small, and it is in reverse bias, but it has not entered into the breakdown. It is under reverse bias condition. Now, if it is under reverse bias condition, so this diode will be off, or you can say that these two terminals are not connected. So this switch is not closed, it is open. So open switch, now if it is open switch, so in that case, the input voltage and the output voltage will be the same, because there is no current, it's an open switch, there is no load resistance, open switch, so no current through this series resistance, so input and output potential will be the same. So the input output will follow the input, just like this. Now if you increase, if you go on increasing the value of the input voltage, now a point will come when the input amplitude is equal to the general breakdown. So whenever the input amplitude equals the general breakdown voltage, then what happens, this voltage equal to like VZ, now this is equal to the general breakdown, that means the cathode to anode potential equal to VZ. Now the general diode enters into the breakdown region. Now when it enters into the breakdown region, and if I assume that the general resistance is equal to 0 ohms, that means this Z value equal to 0 ohm, then eventually this voltage difference between these two terminal will be constant at VZ, unlike your normal diode. For normal diode, we do not prefer to operate the diode in the breakdown region. But for Zener diode, the value of the breakdown region is small enough so that we can control to some extent. But you have to ensure that whenever the input signal is attaining its peak at say 10 volt or so, then also the current that is flowing through the Zener diode, you have to ensure that this diode current must be within the prescribed limit. That means must be within IZM. Enormous amount of current will flow through the diode, and as a matter of fact, the diode may get damaged. So that you have to ensure. Otherwise, this will be constant at VZ. So you can say that it's a kind of positive clipper circuit. The positive part is clipped to some extent. And here you find that this is at minus 0.7 volt. So if I consider the second one, the second circuit is the diode is connected in this fashion. The Zener diode is connected in this way. And you have during the positive half cycle, you'll find that it is like 0.7 volt only. Positive half cycle, 0.7 volt, because the diode is on. During the positive half cycle, the anode and cathode, they are connected together, and the difference between these two points will be like 0.7 volt. But in the negative half cycle, when initially, when the input goes zero or less than zero, then initially the diode will be off. So since the diode is off, the output and the input will be the same. That means output will follow the input. Output waveform will follow the input waveform. But a point will come when the input voltage, magnitude of the input voltage is equal to the magnitude of the Zener breakdown. So in that case, the Zener diode will enter into the breakdown region. And when it enters into the breakdown region, then we can say that this anode and cathode, they are connected together. The current will flow in the reverse direction. During the breakdown, the current will flow into the reverse direction. Because if you can remember the IV characteristics of Zener diode or any diode, you'll see that in the forward bias direction, the current will flow from one side to another side, from P2 N, if I consider, and to cathode. And in the reverse bias region, the current will flow in the reverse region. That is true for a breakdown region as well. Now, let us try to combine these two diagrams together. That means this positive limiter and the negative limiter together. And let us see what will be the output for this type of circuit. Now here we have purposely taken two different Zener diodes having two different value of this Zener breakdown. One is at 3.3 volt and the other one is at 5.1 volt, and we have supplied with 10 volt peak input signal. So 10 volt to minus 10 volt. 1 kilo is the input. I mean the resistance. Series resistance is 1 kilo only. Now, initially, when the input signal is just greater than zero, just like 1 volt or 2 volt, then what happens? You understand that there is two diodes. Two diodes are connected and their cathodes are tied together and the anodes are returned to the corresponding lines, base lines. This line, this is the upper line and this line is connected to the ground line. So here the cathodes are connected together and in figure number B, the anodes are connected together. So obviously I can say that two diodes are connected. That means two switches are connected in series. Now during the positive half cycle, out of these two switches, now if I name the upper diode as D1 and the lower diode as D2, then during the positive half cycle, this diode D1, in the positive half cycle, this diode will be on. There's no doubt about that because the anode terminal is connected to this point and this terminal is positive. So during the positive half cycle, this diode will be on, but this diode will be off initially. Initially, this diode will be off. So what happens? So no current will flow through the circuit, because one switch is closed, one switch is open. So D1 is closed, D2 is open. So no current will flow through this circuit. So input and output, so output will replicate the input. So the pattern is replicated just like this. Now here we are assuming that the diode, whenever the diode is on, there is a 0.7 volt drop. Okay. So since this is on, so we can say that, so there's a 0.7 volt drop between these two points, anode to cathode. Now whenever this potential at this point is equal to 5.8 volt, then you'll see that 5.8 volt is present over here because input will follow the output or output will follow the input, input and output being the same. So when input is equal to 5.8, so the output will also be 5.8 volt. Now this diode will be on because it's a forward bias. So potential at this point will be 0.7 volt less. So 5.8 minus 0.7, that is 5.1 volt. Now here, this is 5.1 volt positive. This is 5.1 volt positive. This is ground. And this Zener diode is having a breakdown voltage of 5.1. So now when the input voltage is 5.8, this is 5.8. So here 0.7 volt drop will take place. So 5.1 here. So now the breakdown, now this diode will break down because this voltage is equal to the breakdown voltage. So then you find that both of these two switches will be closed. This switch because of normal forward bias condition, and this switch D2 is because of the general breakdown region, a general breakdown operation. So 0.7 drop here, 5.1 drop here. So you can expect that plus minus 0.7 plus minus 5.1. So these two batteries, visually you can visualize these two batteries are in the same polarity, just like this plus minus plus minus. So the resultant output voltage will be added, 5.1 plus 0.7, that is 5.8 volt. So this is the scenario during the positive half cycle. Now what happens during the negative half cycle? The same analogy you can explain here. During the negative half cycle, this lower diode, this D2, will be on because the anode side is connected to this point. And during the negative half cycle, this is more positive. This line is more positive with respect to this line. So during the negative half cycle, this diode will be on. This diode will be on, but this diode is off. D2 is on, but D1 is off. Now, whenever the input voltage is equal to 4.7 4 volt only in the negative direction, that means minus 4. Then what happens? So minus 4 here, you can say, so with respect to this point, this will be at plus 4 during the negative half cycle. So 4 here, and then 0.7 drop, anode to cathode, 0.7 drop. So 3.3 here. So 3.3 here. So cathode potential 3.3 with respect to this, cathode potential 3.3. So this diode, this upper diode D1 will break down. So as a matter of fact, when the input voltage is minus 4 volt or even less than that, then both of these two diodes will be on. D2 is off. D2 is on because of the normal forward biasing operation, and D1 will be on because of the general breakdown region. So then, when the input voltage is equal to minus 4 volt or less than that, then the input will be output will be constant at minus 4 volt. Now let us see what is the scenario for this type of circuit. So here the two anodes are connected together, unlike two cathodes. Here two anodes are connected together. Now here, the input voltage input fluctuation is from 220 to minus 20 volt, because one of the Zener diode is having Zener breakdown at 15 volt, and the other Zener diode is having a breakdown at 6.2 volt. Now, during the positive half cycle, you expect that during the positive half cycle, this diode will be on, because the cathode potential will be negative. I mean, cathode potential is less with respect to the anode potential, so this diode should be on, this lower diode, but you cannot have any current through the circuit because this diode is off during the positive half cycle. Now, whenever this potential is at 6.9 volt, when this potential is at 6.9 volt, what you can see is this potential 6.9, now that can be divided into 6.2 and 0.7. So this is always 0.7. So if this diode is on, the drop is 0.7 from this point to that point. Anode to cathode drop is 0.7. And you have additional 6.2 volt drop here. So 6.2 plus 0.7, that is 6.9. So when this is 6.9 volt, or higher than that, then this diode D2 is on because of the normal forward biasing operation. And this diode D1 is on because of the general breakdown operation. So, and even if the input voltage is higher than 6.9, then the output voltage will be fixed at 6.9. I'm assuming that the Zener resistance is equal to zero. So it is constant. So as long as it enters into the breakdown region, it will be constant at 6.2 and 15 volt respectively. Now what happens during the negative half cycle? So during the negative half cycle, so this terminal is much more negative with respect to this terminal. This terminal is much more negative with respect to this terminal. Or in other words, I can say that this terminal is much more positive with respect to this terminal. So during the negative half cycle, this upper diode D1 will be on, but D2 is off initially. Initially, D2 is off. In order to make D2 on, or in order to ensure that the current will flow through D2, the input voltage must be greater than or equal to, I mean, magnitude-wise, it will be greater than or equal to 15.7 volt. Or if I just consider the value, then it should be 15.7 volt minus 15.7 volt or less than that. So if this voltage is minus 15.7 or even less than that, then there is minus 15.7. So the drop will take place here. So minus plus here. So it will be added together. Minus plus, because this is on. This diode D1 is on during the during the negative half cycle. This diode D1 is on. This one is on because this potential is negative with respect to this potential. So minus 15. So you have so if value is like 15 points minus 15.7. So this is divided into these two segments. One is across these two, 0.7 plus minus 0.7, and you have another plus minus here, plus minus 15 volt here across D2, and plus minus 0.7 here across D1. This diode plus minus 15 volt, this diode D2 is on because of the general breakdown operation, and this diode D1 is on because of the normal forward biasing condition. So when the input voltage is higher than magnitude wise, higher than 15.7 in the negative half cycle, then both of these two diodes, both D1 and D2, they will be on. And the output voltage will be constant at minus 15.7 volt, assuming that these two diodes, these two Zener diodes, is having a Zener resistance of 0 ohms. So in this way, you can develop different types of circuits, different types of limiter circuits involving the Zener diode, in addition to the normal low power diode as well. Now with this, I can conclude today's lecture session, and this ends unit one, the first unit of your course that deals with the diode models and different types of diode circuits.